Hello there, and welcome to the Big Bang. Here, we'll talk about biopotential electrodes, and more specifically the silver-silver chloride electrodes used often as reference electrodes. Electrodes are electrical conductors that come in contact with biological tissues or solutions to collect electrochemical measurements. The silver-silver chloride electrodes, for example, can look like webbed disks connected to a cable. In standard bioengineering applications, which you may have experienced firsthand at some point in your life, the electrode is placed on a tissue that has been wetted with a gel. Think of someone getting an EKG. Looking more closely into what is happening at the electrode-electrolyte tissue interface, you would see metal atoms crossing the interface to become cations and meet anions in the electrolyte solution. They do this while leaving behind electrons at the electrode. In essence, what is happening at the interface is a redox reaction. The hypothetical metal M involved could be silver or platinum, for example. As metal atoms leave to become cations in the electrolyte solution, they create a half-cell potential. An important thing to note is that this process is completely reversible. Here's a schematic of the interface again. As you can see, the metal atom loses an electron and becomes a cation, which leaves the electrode to join the anion in the electrolyte solution. The lost electron, on the other hand, stays in the electrode. Naturally, this forms a charged double layer where you accumulate a negative charge at the electrode and a positive charge in the electrolyte. This double layer is not at all desirable, but it is found in what is called polarizable electrodes. This double layer develops a capacitance experience at the interface. It presents a barrier to the activation energy of the electrode, and it prevents charge from flowing, thus leading to poor conductance. A polarizable electrode is only good for measuring high impedance voltages, so as said earlier, not very desirable. In contrast to polarizable electrodes, we have non-polarizable electrodes. Non-polarizable electrodes have a coat that acts as a buffer, allowing current to flow in both directions. This is actually good for measuring both current and voltages. An example of a non-polarizable electrode is actually the silver-silver chloride electrode. Here's how this works. The silver in the electrode will leave an electron in the electrode and move into the silver chloride layer, represented in pink, as a cation. The chloride ion from the electrolyte solution will then travel into the silver chloride layer as well to bind ionically with the silver cation. So you end up depositing a non-soluble layer of silver chloride on the electrode. The coat of silver chloride really acts as a buffer. We can also easily take this current in both directions. We have a much larger supply of chloride in our bodies than silver. The reactions happening here are then first, the silver losing an electron and becoming a cation, and second, the silver cation bonding with the chloride anion to deposit silver chloride on the electrode. And notice that this buffer does not dissolve in solution. If you were to make this electrode by putting silver in bleach and then passing current through it, the more current you pass through the electrode, the bigger the layer of silver chloride created will be. As the electrons and cations are exchanged at the electrode-electrolyte interface, a space charge gives rise to an equilibrium potential that will change the current flowing through the interface. Again, this is like the double layer we discussed earlier, although the effect of this double layer should be smaller with a non-polarizable electrode. Either way, we can compute this electrode's potential by adding the electrode potential and the electrolyte potential. This calculation involves E, the half-cell potential, Vr, the ohmic potential, over potential, Vc, the concentration over potential, and Va, the activity over potential. Let's now explain what these mean. The half-cell potential is a function of the electrode material, the concentration of metal cations in solution in which the electrode is immersed, and the temperature. In principle, there is another half-cell potential at the interface between any two surfaces. Also, for differential biopotential measurements between two identical electrodes, the half-cell potentials cancel out, which is great. This half-cell potential is also relative to the standard hydrogen electrode. The ohmic overpotential is then the series resistance of the electrolyte, and it is non-linearly proportional to the current. The concentration overpotential depends on the actual concentration of the charge on the layer and can be calculated by the following equation. The activity overpotential depends on the conductance due to the activity energy barrier and will be large for polarizable electrodes and small for non-polarizable electrodes with very good conductance. For more details on how these different terms work and can be represented in an electrical model of the electrode, come check out our next video where we will break down all these concepts. I hope this was helpful to you, and I look forward to seeing you next time.